The kiss of death has always blessed us with finality. The grip of sin has clutched our neck and crushed our chest with cold indifference. We felt it, haven't we? The burn of rising anger at injustice, cruelty rejoicing at our weakness, evil's appetite for innocence, the drive that cannot rest while beauty shines unspoiled. Somebody help us. We're paralyzed by eyes of predatory fury. We're trying to run, but with feet nailed down. We're trying to fight, but with hands bound. We're stuck in a trance. We don't stand a chance. Somebody help us. God, I'm afraid. I'm afraid you don't see me. I'm afraid you don't hear me. I'm afraid that your love will extend to the ones I need you to destroy. You could do it, you know. Pour the cup of your wrath on the heads of the ones who deserve it. But I deserve it. And God, I'm afraid. That's when Jesus steps in. Not aloof, not overlooking depravity with rose-colored glasses, but taking it on. He stands in between the prey and the predator, accepting its fangs. With feet nailed down, with hands bound, he offers his flesh as a resting place for wicked indignities. His chest stills. The heel is struck, the head is crushed, the deed is done. The sun is laid to rest, the kiss of death predictably has won. Then the third day comes. The teeth of sin and death cannot retract. They can't escape the crushing blow of heaven's wrath. The cornered beast is latched upon its victim, in whom love and justice overlap. But the victim is the victor. Death defanged, wrath absorbed, sin forgiven, life restored. On the third day, the sun rises. His still chest rises. Hope rises. All creation rises, eyes wide to praise the name of Jesus. Jesus, the one who conquered death and grave. In him, there is a path to freedom, to life, to redemption, to forgiveness. Through rugged cross and empty tomb, he made room for me and you. So what you gonna do? Sit down, unmoved, or stand up and prove that he's worthy? Come on, shout if he's worthy. Come on, get up on your feet and move. Run toward the one who is Lord. It is Jesus. Jesus is risen. Jesus is King. Jesus is Lord. Come on.
Every knee shall bow. Every tongue confess. Jesus is Lord. Jesus is Lord. Every knee shall bow. Every tongue confess. Jesus is Lord. Jesus is Lord.
Every knee shall bow.
Sing every All praise will rise to Christ our King.
Bay Church, thank you for being here on our Easter service. I just want to let you all know, if you see any open room, just scoot on in. We want to make room for everybody that comes in today. Also, we know that the significance of Easter is so big and huge, and we encourage you, don't hold back your praise. If you want to raise your hands, if you want to dance, if you want to sing, God is not dead. He is risen, amen. Give a shout of praise for Jesus this morning. With all that being said, let's continue to celebrate the King of Kings. Come on, put those hands together. Hey, hey.
I'll praise when I'm sure, I'll praise when I'm down. Showed up. too far gone for the on-time God. You always show up. Oh, Jesus, you always show up. Yes, you do, yes, you do. Now that we're here, I give you glory and the praise for all of the years. His loving kindness kept us safe. I know that the storms will always come. Oh, but even when the devil thought he won, that's when you show up. That's what it's all about. Oh, he will always show up. Oh, and if you ever left me, oh, he'll show up. When if you ever left me, come on, let's declare that. When if you ever left me, no, he doesn't leave us. When if you ever left me, you don't leave me. When if you ever, no, you never left me. Oh no, when if you ever left me, oh Jesus, when if you ever left me, oh, when if you ever, you always show up. Oh Jesus, you always show up. I have a history, you always show up.
Well, happy Easter, everybody. It's great to see you. Go ahead and have a seat and make yourself at home. Hello, you wonderful people right up front. We ought to have popcorn and peanut for the up and fronters. I want to say a big welcome as well to those in overflow, those joining us by live stream. So much fun's happening outside. I've been out on the lawn and laughing with kids and families. And I just want to say a huge... I have so missed this family. This is not a job. This is my life. You are my family. You are my peeps. And it's just like, God, I'm so glad to be home. My name is John. I'm one of the pastors here. And I did not grow up in church. Actually, some of you are old enough. Do you remember when hippies were the deal? And the little yellow Volkswagen, my brother had one of these. You know, it's such so predictable. A little yellow Volkswagen, big flower power on it, marijuana smoking out all the windows. Anyhow, my two older brothers came to Christ. And I mean, it was a radical conversion experience and hundreds of thousands of other good hippie brothers and sisters back in the day. At that time, I was still a teenage boy on the farm in overalls, no kidding. So they're doing marijuana, their little yellow Volkswagen, and just, you know, getting on with Jesus. And I'm back there harvesting corn and wheat and wearing overalls. And so they come back and they say, John boy, you're a big fat sinner. You need God. I said, okay. I mean, you do what your older brothers tell you, right? And that began it for me. So I said, okay, now what do I do? They said, well, you need to go to a church. I said, do you got one in mind? And they said, no, we really don't. Get in the yellow pages. Some of you don't even know what that is, the yellow pages. But so I found a church, and I had no religious background. I didn't know the Bible from the man in the moon. And so I just started going, and I found out some of the cutest things about church people. And may I say, some of the weirdest things. Even as just a 16-year-old kid, I'm going, now I wonder why that person does that. That was weird. I'll ask somebody about, now that's weird. I'll have to ask somebody about that. One of the weird things we did, anybody over about the age of 45 will know, you used to walk in church and there was a little thing called bulletins, a little folded piece of paper, and you'd get it, and you always knew because they used the bad typewriter ribbon. You could hardly read it. Lots of typos and misspellings, usually smudged and crooked on the page. But the whole idea is you go to your little seat and read the bulletin, right? So I started collecting some of the things church people say. And I'm not making these things up. Actual human beings in actual churches said these things. And I just think it's weird. Here's one, and I'm quoting them. Don't let worry kill you. Let the church help. Remember in prayer the many who are sick of our church and of our community. For those of you who have children and don't know it, we have a nursery downstairs. If you got kids and don't know it, I don't want to know you. Here's the next one. This afternoon, there will be a meeting in the south and north ends of the church, and children will be baptized at both ends. A bean supper will be held on Tuesday evening in the church hall, and music will follow. At the evening service tonight, the sermon topic will be, "What is hell?" Come early and listen to our choir practice. What else have I got? I got them around here. There we go. Let me just wrap. Well, one says the evening massage is at 6 p.m. Not message, the evening massage. Want to go to that church. Then this final one, what are people thinking? Low self-esteem support group begins at 9 o'clock p.m. Please enter the church by the back door. Guys, I got hundreds of these. That's just some of them. We think very deeply and realistically and as full humans about what a relationship with God means and all the complexities. One thing we really shy against is having silly, frothy, oversimplified answers to the complex questions of life. Life's complex. And we all have very hard parts, and we have some really happy parts. And some of you may be asking the question, so John, it's Easter, and I'm sure at some point we're probably going to talk about Jesus. Yeah, we will, actually, a lot. You're thinking, so John, tell me. It's just a question. Don't be offended, you're saying to me. How can a dead Jewish peasant, which is actually what Jesus was in that moment, a dead Jewish peasant, from the first century in the Middle East, possibly have any relevance to my life in the Bay Area in the 21st century? If you're wondering that kind of a question, I got to tell you, that is a totally relevant question.
That's the kind of stuff, just like throwing a ribeye steak to a pit bull. You want to grab that and really wrestle with it, because the answer to that question will be very important in your life and in mine. So let me do about a minute and a half review. When you think of Easter, think first of Christmas. Christmas is God with us. In other words, the eternal holy God of the universe became man, became flesh, put on skin, and believe it or not, was delivered by about a 14 or 15-year-old teenage girl who was a virgin. You say, that's miraculous. Yes, it is. God with us is Christmas. Easter is God for us. When we say God for us, we think of this statement, which I think summarizes it all. The life of Jesus was from a virgin's womb to an empty tomb. The beginning and the end. No, not the end, because on the third day he rose again and is alive forevermore. Because what Jesus did in the tomb on that Friday, Saturday, Sunday morning when he arose, death was defeated by life. Jesus dealt a death blow forever to death, and in its place established life. And that's why he said, come to me, all you who are weary and long for life, you're heavy laden, you're thirsty, you're hungry, come to me and I will satisfy the deepest legitimate yearnings of your heart. We're in a biblical series these days called Proverbs. We're calling it Wisdom Culture. You say, John, what is wisdom? Knowledge is the acquisition of facts. Wisdom is the right application of knowledge, the right application of those facts. There's a lot of really smart, highly academically pedigreed people that kind of have a tough time, hit a lot of speed bumps in everyday life because they're not properly implementing what they know into a winning way, a healthy way, a life-giving way in their everyday life. We're looking at one verse today, just one verse out of Proverbs, only four words. And I want you to hide these four words in your heart because they could change you. It's Proverbs 10:12, and it's this: love covers all wrongs. Just that, love covers all wrongs. Let's talk for a few minutes about each one of those four words and their implications in our lives. The ground zero, the bottom line, the mighty foundation of relationship with God is to understand the love of God. I want to contend that the love of God is the most powerful force in the universe, greater by infinity than any power mankind, humankind, in our scientific, technological brilliance have created, much of which is for destruction. The love of God is infinitely more powerful. And it's that love of God, Jesus is saying, that if you will invite me to do so, I will come into your life and I will cover all of the wrongs you've committed, all of the sins that you've committed. Now, you say, John, okay, tell me what cover means. Let me tell you, first of all, what cover doesn't mean. Cover does not mean to ignore. It does not mean to sweep it under the rug, knowing that all the wrongs, all the stuff are still under the rug. To cover means to remove. To cover means to make it gone, to disappear. And when God forgives, he not only forgives, but he forgets. He's not going to bring it up over and over again and grind our face in it. And if you're thinking the offense I've committed, the wrongs that I've executed, the sins that I must own, they are too big for God to cover. No, they are not. There is no wrong that we have committed that is too big for the holy, just, loving God of the universe to cover fully, completely and forever with his love for you. So we've dealt with two words. Love, by definition, describing God's love, is an unconditional commitment to an imperfect person. and cover is to remove, absolve. What happens in many therapeutic places today, people that are struggling with guilt and shame, by the way, you may not know this. Do you know that guilt and shame are a good thing? You said they don't feel like a good thing. You know why they're good? It's because you and I have a conscience. That's one of the ways that we, you and I, are fearfully and wonderfully made, created in the image of God. We have a conscience. And when we do wrong things, and we all know what we're talking about, it's actually good to feel guilty. It's our conscience speaking to us, saying, you intuitively know that what you just did was selfish, cruel, mean, whatever it is. Now, you can silence the voice of conscience over time. I used to play guitar, and if you play and play and play a lot, it just kills your fingers for the first few months. But after a while, when you get calluses, you don't even feel it. You and I can create calluses over our conscience, and we can pretty soon continue to do wrong incessantly without any tinge of guilt. You may have seen people like that. You're saying, how could one person do that much wrong, hurtful stuff in their life? They have silenced the voice of conscience. Love is an unconditional commitment to an imperfect person. To cover means to remove. You say, John, why is this important? Well, this is important because we human beings are a very needy species. You guys all know the popular song, Looking for Love in All the Wrong Places. I should say popular 35, 40 years ago, but for those of you that go retro, you still know. And we human beings are trying to fulfill the very legitimate need of love in our lives in some really unhealthy, destructive ways. We're looking for love. That's legitimate, to fill this God-shaped vacuum hole in our soul. But how we go about it often breaks our heart further and can even just kind of burn down our lives. And so we find ourselves, not intentional, we're just trying to figure out this thing called life. We find ourselves going from bar to bar, toy to toy, fad to fad, fun fix to fun fix, lover to lover. And at the end of the day, we still say, why am I not happy? I should be happy. I've got stuff, I've got a job, I've got health. Why? What is this gnawing thing in me? Honestly, I'm just telling you, it's God. It's the God piece. God created us in his image for himself. And when we're not in relationship with the very God that's created us in his image for himself, life's just a round peg in a square hole. It's an awkward approach. So this love of God began on Friday. The self-sacrificing love of Jesus on the cross demonstrates love. This rising from the dead resurrection Easter Sunday morning demonstrates the love of God as well. And Jesus Christ, when he came, is love living for the first time ever. Now, we need to know this stuff because we all have these burning, what shall we call them, existential questions. Man, this stuff used to chew me up and spit me out. And I remember really starting to think these things in my early teenage years. Now, kind of framing it in 13-year-old ways, but I begin to wonder, who am I and why am I here? And then ultimately, where will I go when I die? Those are, in some sense, if you distill it down, like the three ultimate essential questions, existential, and they torment us. That's why this stuff is so important, because there is, at the end of the day, an ultimate human problem. You say, John, what's that ultimate human problem? Well, it depends who you ask in the room. For some of you, the ultimate human problem is fossil fuels destroying the ozone layer. That's a very serious situation, no doubt. But it's not the ultimate problem, but it's something we should talk about and fix. Some of you would say the billions of little pieces of plastic in the oceans of the planet. It's terrible. It is. And we should come together as humans and fix it. But it's not the ultimate problem. Some of you are thinking, AI, what is AI? What's going to happen to this next generation? I got kids. I got grandkids. What's the world coming to? Are we all going to fall off the abyss? How about this ultimate issue, this tension? We as Americans are going to be doing something as a Democratic Republic in November called voting for a president. And you're saying, John, I got to vote for one of those two old guys? Can we make this multiple choice this year? Like when we go in to vote, we have multiple choice. A, no. B, no. What is C? I need C to arise and give us some hope and some clarity and a way forward and a way of hope. Here's the ultimate problem, everybody. It's the ultimate problem for which Easter, which killed death, is the ultimate answer, and it's this: that one day, each one of us is going to die. I'm a pastor. You know how many people I've buried? Hundreds of people. I've stood by grave sites and pounding snowstorms, pouring rain, sunny, beautiful bluebird days, and I have watched people sob and weep and wail as they let go into the soil of the earth somebody that was the most important being to them in this life. And someday that will be our turn as well. By the way, on the subject of death, one of the things I preach most often, and as you begin to mature in your faith, I think you'll begin to own this too. If we believe that God is sovereign, meaning all-powerful, and if simultaneously we believe that God is just, ultimately fair, then you and I, if we understand we're in the Father's hands like this, you and I are invincible and immortal until we have accomplished in this life and on this earth all that He ever intended for us to do. And then we die. We go home, we change bodies, we slip out of one and slip into another. It's an eternal promotion. Invincible and immortal until we've accomplished all. The statement I want to make to you to really cause us to think deeply is that I don't think we're ready to live until we're ready to die. I think if we don't deal with ultimate issues in our life, we just kind of hydroplane lightly on the surface of life's issues. We're not really going down deep and wrestling with the implications of who I am and why am I here and where will I go when I die. We're just kind of going from what, but we're never going deep, just hydroplaning off surface issues. Here's an alternative. I am just going to humbly ask you to consider believing this. And here's what this is. This is that the cross is God's monument to forgiveness. Please believe that. Please believe that the empty tomb is God's power to authorize that very forgiveness. Please believe that the resurrection of the Son of God, God the Son, from the dead on that first Sunday morning forever destroyed our last and greatest enemy, death. Please understand that when we begin to enter into relationship with God, everything becomes very clear. We've solved the great problems internally, and now we can live life with joy, abandon, no fear, hope, wonder. We can live that way instead of constantly looking over our shoulder. I'm busted, I'm bad, I live in shame, I'm guilty. I've been told this about myself, whatever. And you learn really to listen to one, because Jesus said it. He said, my sheep know my voice. And after you know him for a while, you'll begin to know his voice for your life. And he's infusing in you peace, joy, hope, life, clarity, all the good things that he created for us to enjoy in this world. There's one more thing I need to add, and you're not going to like this as much as what we've talked about so far. This love that covers all wrongs, it goes two ways. It's the vertical. That's what we've been talking about so far, God's love covering our wrongs. But don't forget the horizontal plane. That's the part we're not going to like. You know, to dwell above with those we love, that would be such glory. To dwell below with those we know, my God, that's another story, right? you know, I'm cool with God. It's just the people I live with. It's the neighbors I got. It's the working colleague. It's those people on BART, you know, whatever the deal is. God is saying, my child, if you ask, I extend to you my grace and mercy, my love that will cover all of your wrongs. But then here's my ask of you, my child, says the Father. Would you extend in kind the very same to your fellow man and woman? Would you be gracious as I've been gracious? Would you be merciful as I've been merciful? Because God's forgiveness of us is very directly linked to our willingness to forgive one another. In other words, those who are forgiven must themselves forgive. And here's what you are going to wildly discover, that forgiveness sets the captive free. But it's not the captive you think. Forgiveness sets the captive free only to discover the prisoner was me. Was me. We imprison ourselves in airtight chambers of hostility, revenge, hatred, bitterness, and it's almost like a spiritual malignancy, a cancer which eats us up from the inside out. It's like taking poison, hoping the other guy dies. But we usually kill ourselves first before there's any painful consequence for them. Let it go. Extend to others the same love and mercy God has extended to us. Last thing. What cannot be refuted about all this stuff I'm sharing with you about the love of God, it cannot be refuted that Jesus Christ changes lives. You know, there's close to 3 billion of us on the planet today. Of the over 8 billion, there's 3 billion of us in every continent, every land, every language, every tongue that would say, I follow Jesus Christ. You are not part of a splinter group. You are part of the planet's main event. And that should give you really great joy and great confidence. Jesus is not helping us cope with guilt and shame. Jesus is taking away guilt and shame in our lives. And what remains, what happens at the end is transformation, not behavior modification, transformation. We are changed. And the love of God provides kind of a cosmic wide reboot for us as individuals, but also for the whole human family. The end. We've got some more wonderful things coming in our service right now, but I want to suggest to you, you don't need to see to believe. In our Western logic-based, empirical-based culture, you say, I'll believe it when I see it, when it can be repeated in controlled scientific laboratory setting and I can control how the experiments run and we repeatedly see the same outcome, then I'll think about buying into it. That's not the way the world of the spirit works. We don't have to see to believe. We have to believe, and then we see. I'll be back in a few moments.
That was like a question for me. How am I going to know what his will is? Well, you pray, and then you decide, and if you have peace about that decision, then you know it's his will.
Come. Don't give up on me yet. I know I'm not your best bet, but I'm trying. Don't give up on me yet.
My name is Deborah, and I've been addicted to alcohol all my life. I took my first drink when I was 10, and I drank all up until I was probably 40, 5, maybe 50. I always believed in God, but I didn't have a relationship with him. I came from a broken family. My mom and dad were alcoholics. They were never home. I basically was on my own. In 2004, I decided to go to a program because I was so tired of drinking and doing drugs. But I felt I needed to get sober. I really wanted to get sober. So I was able to stay sober for 6.5 years. But then I always had this hole in my heart. So I drank. And I drank for a couple years, maybe a year. And I went to church drunk. And then one time, a church teen challenge came to my church. And I felt like that was the Lord giving me an opportunity.
So far, but got so far to go. And with these brand new scars, this broken heart, it's hard to really know if there's a reason and if I'll ever see it. But I wanna believe it. Don't give up on me, yeah. No, don't give up on me, yeah, oh, please.
I had filled that hole, the void that I was trying to fill with drugs, alcohol, men. And that's when I became having a relationship with Jesus. He like filled that hole. I felt like I was always looking for love in wrong places. And he showed me that he always loved me. He was always there for me, even when I wasn't following him. He's done so much in my life. He's got me through a lot of trials and I'm so grateful to be clean and sober today, and that's all because of him.
So far, but got so far to go.
I'm got so far to go.
And with these brand new scars and this broken heart, it's hard to really know
if there's a reason and if I'll ever see it. But I wanna upon me, yeah.
Please, God,
don't give up on me. Oh, please, don't give up on me. His grace will never run out. No, it won't.
Don't give up on me.
Oh, there's enough to go.
If you know,
if you know,
he knows,
oh, he knows,
he knows.
same. You knew that I would change, and I think that you're trying to tell me it's okay. Yeah. I know I've come so far, but got so far to go. And with these brand new scars, it's really hard to know if there's a reason and if I'll ever see it. I wanna believe it. Oh, don't give up on me yet. Please, God, don't give up on me. Please don't give up on me.
Would you join me in prayer? Just bow your heads wherever you're at. By the way, when we do this, it gives us a moment of privacy to reflect, to really think about what we've just seen, heard, and experienced. Some of you are ready today to begin your relationship with Christ, or maybe for you, it's a reboot, a start up again, because maybe once upon a time you had a close walk with God, and for whatever reason, the complexities of life, just you drifted. And it's okay, because we can start again. Why? Because God's love covers all wrongs. If today you'd like to enter into relationship with Christ, begin that transformational experience to simply believe. This is not about joining the Bay Church. This is about becoming a child of God, a son, a daughter of God, the global family of God. It's about assuring that you can live this life in all its fullness, while equally being prepared for what's to come in the next life. Raise your hand if that's you. I want to include you in our final prayer. All over the house, just raise your hand up high. Raise it up and hold it up. That's right. Yes, yes, yes. Hold them up. Keep them up with me if you would. Raise them high. Raise them up and hold them up. Raise them up and hold them up. Is there anybody else? You know that that should be you as well. Keep those hands aloft. Father, we do come in prayer. And what we're asking is for each man and woman that's here in the room right now that holds their hand aloft, that they immediately, personally experience the transformational love and grace of God in their person, that they sense the kindness and the smile of God the Father. I pray, Lord, that you would let it be true again what's been happening really through the ages, that if any man or woman enters into relationship with Christ, they instantaneously, because the power of that love of God, they instantaneously become a new woman in Christ, a new man in Christ, new human beings, all of their wrongs forever forgiven. And you have put them on a high place, Father God, in relationship with you. And give them, going forward from this momentous day, a permanent peace that is not affected by the turmoil of daily living, because now they know the reason why. Thank you for your love for each one of us, in the name of Christ our Lord. And everyone said, amen, amen, amen. So hold steady. We've got just a couple more things to come, which we think you are gonna love. Until then, I love you all. Happy Easter, everybody.
For those of you that made a decision to follow Jesus with your life, that's the greatest decision you could ever make. And we want to partner with you on my left, your right, when we conclude in a little while from now. There's a prayer area. We'd love for you to go by there. If you're in our overflow, that area is in the back. And if you are watching online, just hit that connect button. And we've got a little gift we want to be able to give to you. And you go by that area. It's a little book of John. And it's the Gospel of John that you can read through. It's yours to keep. And if you read through that, there's a little coupon in there where you can actually come back and we'll give you a study Bible once you finish reading through the book of John to help you in your journey with Jesus. And we want you to know you're part of a community. One of the most important things you can do as you make this decision is it takes steps to walk in relationship with other people that are also pursuing Jesus. So make sure you go by, receive some prayer, be encouraged. We got that gift for you. And make sure you stay connected in community. My name is Jason. I'm one of the executive pastors here on staff. And we just want to say a big warm welcome for Easter to you.
My name is Olympia, and I'm one of the kids pastors here. Bienvenidos. Mi nombre es Olympia, y soy uno de los pastores de niños aquí. Y queremos decir que los niños son una prioridad aquí en the Bay Church. Kids are a priority here at the Bay Church.
That's right. And if you're new with us or you're visiting, right in the seat back in front of you, a little card says Connect. There's a little QR code on it you can scan if you're new or if you began that journey with Jesus. It'll help us get more connected with you, make sure we follow up with you really well. And so that's just right in the seat back in front. And if you say, hey, I'd like to talk to somebody about this church and learn a little bit more, you can also take that card and pull it on the back. There's some information you can fill out. And we'll be out at our connection kiosk out in the lobby to be able to answer any questions you have and hopefully make this an even more enjoyable experience for you.
That's right. We have our Connect booth out in the lobby. We also have our Kids Camp kiosk out there. And we finally get to share with you our camp theme of the summer. And it is...
Drum roll, please.
Treasure of the Bay.
Treasure of the Bay. It's going to be a lot of fun.
That's right. It's going to be so much fun. I hear Pastor Jason's going to be dressed as a pirate. I might be dressed as a pirate. And you might be, too, because we need volunteers to help carry this out. We are starting up in Concord, July 9th through 11th, and in Brentwood, June 25th to 27th. You can see the QR codes there on the screen. If you would like to participate and volunteer, just scan the QR code that you see there on the screen. And if you have any questions, you can head to our kiosk where you can get any of those questions answered. And don't forget, in 2 weeks, the kids' registration is opening up. So make sure you mark your calendars. We would love for you and your kids to be a part of all the fun that we're having here this summer.
Yeah, we're all about investing in the lives of children, also in the lives of students and youth. And so we're going to have an amazing youth camp this summer that's coming up as well at Old Ork Ranch over in Sonora. So we want to make sure that our students are able to be a part of that. And so it does cost money to go to these camps, but we believe in the power of those moments and how they can transform the life of an individual and really impact families. And so you're going to see in an effort to help raise some funds so everybody can go to camp, we're doing some merch sales. We've got shirts like this, Loving God, Loving People. We've got the ones that me and Olympia are wearing, Be the Good. And there's a lot of merch out there, as well as our sweatshirts that sold out, but we're going to be reordering next week. But all the proceeds, every dollar that we're going to raise is going to go towards providing scholarships for kids and for students to go to camp. So go out there, buy your merchandise. If you want to give an extra donation, feel free. It's going to be a blessing to them, and we're really believing for some great things as a result. Thank you guys so much for your kindness and generosity.
And Easter is such a great time for family and friends to get together and to celebrate all that Jesus has done for us. And we're so glad that you chose to celebrate with us here at the Bay Church. Don't forget, in the Connect lobby, in the lobby, we have our Connect booth, we have our camp kiosk, and we have the merch for sale that benefits our camps. But not only that, we have some amazing stuff out there in the patio. We got lemonade, we got churros. You gotta roll your R when you order it.
That's right. We got cotton candy. You can wrap in your churro if you want a real sugar high, right?
Yes, you can do that too. And we got inflatables, and we got an egg hunt for you and your kids. So make sure you enjoy all the fun things we have planned for you guys today.
And before we wrap up, we're going to have, don't leave yet, because we're going to have a song and we're going to have a video that's going to play that shows you some of the highlights of our previous camps for students and children. So you don't want to miss that. But we're going to go to a brief time of giving. If you're a guest with us, don't feel obligated to give. But as we give at the Bay Church, generosity is a big part of our heartbeat. And so as you give through the Bay Church to make a difference in the KISS community locally and also around the world through many people we support in sharing the good news of Jesus. And so there's three ways you can give. You can give in the buckets as they come by in just a moment. You can give by going to text to give on the number on the screen and just typing in the word give. Or you go to the bay.church/give.
And I want to invite you back next week. On your seats, there's actually a little flyer that's got a bunch of events. And we're jumping into our series in the book of Proverbs this next week. It's called Wisdom Culture. We're going to be talking about marriage and sex. We're going to be talking about how do I hear God's voice. We're going to be talking about mental health. We're also going to be talking about leadership over the next number of weeks. We don't want you to miss out on that. Go ahead and watch this clip of the camps that happened last year and enjoy. Check it out.
Bay Church, feel free to stand with us and we're going to celebrate with this last song. Come on.
In the beginning, you sent the earth spinning, fashioned us from the dust. And since our existence, there's only been one mission. For you to commune with us. And then came the garden, we became the fallen. Sin made us lose our way. Oh, but the love that's too good to give up set a course for amazing grace. This is the gospel, this is the good news. Tell everybody how we save you. This is the gospel, come hear the good news. Tell everybody, there's a God that loves you. Oh, how he loves you. There's a God that loves you. Oh, how he loves you. There's a God that loves you. Then came the Savior, was born in a manger, raised up to rescue us. Healing the blind, raising dead back to life, all the signs of his perfect there on the cross, how we paid every cost. He defeated death, hell, and grave. And on that third morning, the stone started rolling. Oh, what a beautiful day. This is the gospel. That love.
Bay Church. Thank you for being here with us this Easter. We hope to see you next week. Have a blessed rest of your day.